this is the time and then in the period that we are studying and we are doing the Torah, that we are almost in the middle of the scriptures, and this is a very crucial part of the teachings from the Torah. As you know, for almost 8 years now, maybe a little less or more, I have been bringing to you something that is different to most of the synagogues and other religious groups. I have called myself anti-religious, and sometimes this has created a little bit of problems or misunderstandings, because all depends on semantics and how we understand the word religious. For some people, the word religious means something good. For other people, the word religious is something totally negative. When I was a young man, I decided to belong to a group called socialists and lefties. And I was an admirer of one of my own people, Karl Marx and Engels. All of them, by the way, if they existed, they would be the kibbutzim of the time. You know, they believe in being all together and equal. And Karl Marx defined religion as the opiate of the people, a drug. And I still believe that that's true, the way that I understand religion. And because many people say, how you call yourself a rabbi, and you have been in the smicha as a rabbi, how can you say that religion is the opiate of the people? Then all depends also in semantics, in the giving the real value to the words, and to understand the words for what they mean, not for what we have made it believe that they mean. Many times we read the Torah, and sadly enough, many of the words and the way they have been translated are words that has already passed their time. And we are forced to go back to a time in which we do not understand the real value or the real meaning of the word. Then I call instaurated a system, they call it, to the paradigm shift. We needed to get out of our little box that we have been formed through the years, and get out from all the religious systems, and to trying to be open to our Creator in a way that He, as always has done, revealed to us. He is the one that revealed His word. He has given us His word on Har Sinai, you know, and He has given His word to the people. And He said that it's not only for you, but for the people who are going to come. And it's for us, for today, and it's applicable, and the Torah. And this word, they will call the 10 words or the 10 principles or the 10 sayings, the 10 commandments, is the basic of the constitution of Israel. Only these 10 words, no more, no more, no much. But with the time, they were adding and creating more and more clarification or stipulation of trying to make it understand better in which areas we needed to apply. Many times, we need to understand that they needed to be applied according to the time in where they were living. And they needed to apply according to the mentality of the time. I mentioned to you that what the most important thing, it is not about to be literalist, but that we need to understand the principle behind the sayings of the Torah. You know, the great rabbi, Moshe Nachmanides, Rambam Uin, not the other Maimonides, he used to say that not only we need to avoid the literal understanding of the scriptures, but we need to understand the spirit of the Torah. And even that now, the spirit of the Torah sometimes has fallen in really hard hands. Why? Because most of the time, most of the interpretation that we have of the Torah and the scriptures are based on religious traditions. And religion traditions sometimes are like a suicide. Let me explain to you. Suicide, I define suicide as a permanent solution for a temporal problem. You know? Then, tradition sometimes, they give a permanent idea how to do it for a temporal situation. And we continue doing it even that already has passed the reason why to be. I am, and I come, from the Sephardim background. And many of my traditions I learned are very different to the Ashkenazim. Right now in Israel, Eretz Israel, the Ashkenazim tradition is imposing on all over the area, and they are taking over. And many of my traditions are disappearing. And they're becoming, depending which group do you belong, you can be very strict, very, very strict, or a little bit strict. You know, depending how you like it, how you do it. And that has become more to the person who wants to do it or doesn't want to do it. And this is the problem when we misunderstand the principle of the Torah. Because the principle of the Torah, it is not black and white. That is a totally a Gentile mentality. Sorry to tell you, you're Gentile, don't get upset with me, but it's what I call it the Greek mentality. You know, the Aristotelian mentality. Very rational, and you want to go from point A to point B, you know, a straight line, and then you want to go to the reduction, to the atom, to the punctilio, to the minimum, and then you make your definition. The Hebrew mentality is totally the opposite. It's totally different. It is more like a holistic. And you know why? That's the reason when they say to use three opinions. And we do not have any problem with that. We love to walk in the gray area. We're neither white or black. We're always gray. Because this is the real name for Israel. You need to understand what Israel really means. A constant struggle we are creator. We are constantly fighting. He always wins, but we have our words. You know, and we need to tell him sometimes our opinion. And we are very opinionated. You know, doesn't mean that our opinion is correct. Doesn't mean that the way that we believe is right, but at least we are alive. You know, when you become put in a mark on a box, and you cannot get out of that box, you become constricted, and you become like in a prison, and you cannot exercise the God-giving gift of your own free will. That this is the greatest gift that our Creator gave us to differentiate ourselves from anything else that He has created. Even beyond the angels, we could do something that not even the angels sometimes had the possibility to do. We were more free to do it. We could opinionate, could talk, could think, and even we can disobey if we wanted all the time. You know? Of course, there were consequences, but we were given by our Creator that freedom. What we have confused is the idea of freedom with libertines, you know, that we, without understanding. Many times in this community, I have had people that has come to me and said, Rabbi, I want to become a Jew. And always my question is, why do you want to become a Jew? I want to convert. And I say, what do you want to convert? You're not happy the way that you were born? You know? What, do you think our Creator committed a mistake with you? You know? You think you can become going from a leopard, you can become a lion or something like that? You know, you are who you are. You know, even in Jeremiah Hanavi, the prophet Jeremiah say, you know, everybody needs to be according to the way. Come, the leopard change the spots. can the Ethiopian, can the color of the skin, can it just be something else? You know, we are who we are. And assume that you accept who you are, you're going to start to live. Because you don't need to be somebody else. You need to be what God made you, gave you. And this is the most important. Now, being part of Israel is a totally different thing. Because that is a calling. That is something that God brings to you. And you know, as many of the people have this wrong idea that Israel is a race. You know, Israel has nothing to do with race. Israel has to do with calling. I already has explained that before. I don't want to repeat myself, but I want to give you this idea. Israel is our Creator brings people from all over and bring it to Him. He called them. He called Abraham Avin. He was an Aramaic. Okay? And he was no Israelite. He was no Jew. No? And he the father of Israel. And please, we need to understand certain things. Do you know when Israel left Egypt? Do you think it was all the pure land Israel who came out of Egypt? You know, we wanted or not, we brought a lot of Arab rab. And the Arab rab, sometimes they were more than us, you know. And they got with us, and they intermingled with us, they intermarried with us. They became us. Then, what kind of race is that? You know, like I met a friend of mine, that I said, he had a little dog, and I say, what race it is? And he say, who knows? You know, the poor little dog, very cute, but I mind that he has more than 70 races inside, you know? Then, most of us are like that. Some of us that we didn't think we were mixed, we are mixed, sorry to tell you. You know, and then, please, don't start with us that, in that area. But God brought us together. He called us and He put in our hearts that desire to follow Him. And to follow Him is to follow Torah. This week, there is a break or a change of the direction of the Vayikra HaSefer, the book of Leviticus. And here, he's going to start with this wonderful words that he's going to say. He said, Be'amarta Elehem, tell them, Kedoshim Tiju, Ki, Kadosh Ani Adonai Elehem. No? They shall be holy, because I am holy. Now, in the Hebrew language, sometimes it looks like that. The first part, the reading, is precede the second part. But usually, is the change. It's like in Spanish and English. You know, in Spanish we say Casablanca. In English you say White House. Now, if you're in Spanish you say Blanca Casa, sounds a little strange. And you say in English, a house white, you know, sound little, but Hebrew similar. Then you need to understand in the mentality of the Hebrew language what he said. And basically what God did is, you know, let me use these words, okay? I am totally different. I am unique. And you shall be unique because you belong to me. That sounds much better or not? I take away all the religious things here, the holiness and the frying, because a people, oh, I am holier than thou. They are more holy than anybody, you know. I got desperate. That is the religious people, okay? They love to be holy, and they even don't know. And many of them, they are holy, but they are holy for evil, okay? And the word holy can be used for good and for evil. If you go to Bereshit, Genesis 38:21, you know, when Judas goes to look for and see a prostitute on the streets. You know, that was his daughter-in-law. She is referred to Hakerusha. Kedusha. You know? Kedusha. She's a holy. And that was, they say that was a holy prostitute. But Kedusha. You go to Devarim, Deuteronomy 23:17 in the Hebrew Bible, 18 in the Christian Bible. You want to see again? You know, you shall not make your children all dedicated to holy prostitutes, females, and prostitutes, males. You know, what is the word that's used? Kedasha, Kadash. Again, holy, holy. Then, for those who say, I am holy, I will say, what kind of holy? You know, holy that you have a lot of holes, or holy that you are complete. You know, and all these things is because the misunderstandings and the no putting in directly the meanings of the word. But what it means is this. When God said that we shall be part of him, we are his property, we belong to him. That is the idea, belonging to him. Now, immediately he's going to develop again, almost a repetition, the Ten Commandments, he's going to give us the Ten Words, and he's going to clarify other areas. And one of the areas that he is going to develop, interestingly enough, and now is so popular, is about the sexuality. And chapter 18 and 20, going to talk about sexuality. And one of the areas they're going to talk is about homosexuality. You know? That to tell you about how difficult it is today. Because now we have learned about to be political correct, and we need to learn to be sociological correct, and even more, we need to be theological correct. We are not allowed to say the thing for what they say. Now we need to really be careful because I don't want to hurt any feelings. And what is interesting is that there is a very powerful lobby about these groups of people that are imposing the way of thinking to the rest of the world. And the rest of the world, instead to say, enough is enough, we are bowing our heads to them. And that's not right. One thing is to say, I do not agree with you. Another thing is to say, I need to kill you. Okay? It's two different things. We have the right to say, I do not agree with you. Everybody has the right to live according to the way that they want to live. If they want to destroy themselves, they can destroy themselves. But they cannot force me to be destroyed with them. This is the point that I always try to make about thinking out of the box. It is not to be judgmental or being better than the others. I am totally again holier than thou. You know why? Because all of us, we have a lot of holes in ourselves. And there is no one here that can tell me, oh, I am better than you are. You know, sometimes to me the saddest part that I see among ourselves is that we start comparing with each other. I always say, you know, you want to compare with somebody. Compare with him, with the Creator, and you're going to see how far away you are. Then you're going to be a little more modest. You know, I'm trying to be this in this way. Well, this is the problem. That we have been forced to follow religious traditions instead to follow the true meaning of the Torah. You know, our Creator gave us the Torah to give us life, to give us life in abundance, to make us live. When somebody said to me, I would like to convert to Judaism, when I ask you why, no, because the Jews are very smart. Oh, that's good. Oh, why? Because because the Jews have a lot of money. Oh, sounds very good, no? You know, do you know, I wish that people would say, because the Jewish people follow the Torah. But that's the least that they think about it. You see, to follow the Torah, that is the real Israelite. It's a way of life. It is not a religious ordinance or religious things to do, but it's a living aspect. It's alive. Every day we need to do it. You know why? Because our Creator has given us free will, but also has given us conscience. And then we constantly, every day, we need to be constantly struggling. And like I said to you, the name Israel, struggling with God, we are constantly struggling. If you are one of the very, very holy men or women, that you do not struggle with God at all because you have everything perfect and you do everything right, you know, you are wasting your time to come here, to be honest with you, and to even to listen to me, because you are beyond all of us. You need to go to Mars or another planet, because you don't exist here. But for all of us, that we are human beings, basically human beings, and we are constantly struggling to do what is right. And most of the time, we fail. We get close sometimes, but we fail. You know? And every time that we fall, He is there to pick us up. Why we are picked up? When we acknowledge that we have done wrong. But meanwhile, we do not acknowledge, we are going to be like the worms or the snakes, you know, on the surface of the land, crawling. And our Creator wants us up. This one of the chapters in this parasha, where it was an inspiration for our Messiah Yeshua, a beautiful inspiration. When He was asked by the Perushim, what is interesting, the word Pharisees, really the word in Hebrew is Perushim. And then Perushim is a similar word. There are similar words in Hebrew that have similar meanings. Holy is one. Nida is another one. For the women, that Nida sounds so ugly, but Nida is similar. And the other word is Perushim, what it means is separate ones, to be separate. The Nida means to separate, doesn't mean menstruation, by the way. Okay? But they use it in the chapter, in the Talmud, the portion of the Nida, especially for the women, because talking about the separation of the women when they go through their process that we already have talked about. Well, that to tell you words are words, but if we do not understand it in the right meaning, we can arrive to wrong ideas. And each one is going to make their own definitions. And what we need to understand, what is our Creator giving to us and trying to inform us. Then, when you have all this information, the question is, what do I do with this information? How do I put in practice? I always have told you that to follow the Torah is something alive. And it's everyday business. It's not once a week when you come on Shabbat and you say, mea culpa, mea culpa, mea culpa, for three times. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with that everyday living, every second, every minute, every hour in your life. This is to walk with Torah. To say that we are Shomer Torah, that we keep the Torah, doesn't mean that I am religious, but what it means that every day in my life, our Creator is always with me, walking with me, looking at me. And our Messiah Yeshua did exactly the same thing. And that's the reason to me that I call myself Meshachim Yehudim, a Messianic Jew. Because I have learned about Yeshua, not only as my rabbi, as a prophet, because he said things that was going to happen. And he did things amazingly. But one of the things that he taught was nothing new, if we can, because he didn't invent the Torah. The Torah was already given. As many people trying to, and this is the problem with the rabbis who do not believe in the Messiah, Yeshua, and other religions who have made Yeshua something else who he is not. Both sides, to me, are totally wrong. That is the reason that religion sometimes is bad. Because each religion has made their own definitions about what is what and what is not. And they have not given room for the truth, because each one of them trying to deny each other. You know, Yeshua, as a teacher, as a rabbi, he gave us a beautiful, beautiful teachings and sermons, you know, the so-called Sermon on the Mountain. Yeah, and I always caution people, when you read a Sermon on the Mountain, be sure you are reading words from Yeshua, not reading words from the editors of the so-called New Testament. I call it the wrong terms, New Testament. I call it the Messianic writings about the Messiah Yeshua. But here is what is important is, here comes a group of Perushim, Pharisees, and they ask, and scribes, suffering, you know, and they come to ask him, teacher, rabbi, you know, tell us, what is the most important part of the scriptures? You know, and he is going to give that beautiful teaching. That was nothing new. We already had heard almost 90 years prior to Yeshua, or 50 years prior to Yeshua, Hillel, the great teacher. No? And what he says is, you know, love the God with all your mind, with all your being, with your everything. You know, he's using the Shema and Devarim, Deuteronomy. And then he's going to use this portion, you know, in Vayikra 19:18, you know, and love your neighbor as you love yourself, you know. This is something that is very important to understand what he's saying. Know what the religious people are trying to explain to you from one side or the other. But what he really is saying. First of all, even the word ahava, the word love, has nothing to do with the idea of love today, not with the Greek, and not with the other the languages or type of understanding. He's talking about a word that what the basic meaning is be loyal. That's what it means. Ahava means loyalty. To be loyal. Not to be kushi-kushi. No, nothing to do with that. Not give it to February. You know, to San Valentin, no? The big heart. You know, even that, only to tell you, do you know that in the Hebrew language, the word lev has nothing to do with feelings? No at all. Lev has to do with understanding, volition, will, and intention. Has nothing to do with feelings. When you want to talk about feelings in the scripture, in the Torah, they talk about your bowels, your tripas, your kishkish. Now that is what I'm talking about, feelings. Oh, I am in love. You need to do this, okay? But don't say, oh, I am in love. No. When you say this, I am loyal too. See the difference? Then we see that we are changing, and we need to understand and bring the scriptures to the right terms. And this is what religion has done. Has given us so many traditions that little by little has destroyed the word of God. And that's exactly what our Messiah Yeshua told us. It's exactly what he said. You religious deprives, you know, the fanatics. You have given your own word, your own understanding, your own meaning to the point you have totally destroyed the word of God. And today, at this moment that I am talking to you, that is exactly what happened. Yeshua came to bring us back to Torah, to be Shomer Torah. And what we have done? Totally the contrary. Some groups say that the Torah is only for the Jewish people. And the other group say that the Torah is not any longer valid because Yeshua destroyed the Torah or abolished the Torah or made the Torah, he gave his own Torah. The one that he said that has not come to change one word, one little jot, has not come to do anything against the word of God, now they put him as the culprit of destroying the Torah. That to tell you about what religion is so bad. And many of us, we have got it, keep it, and we don't even realize that we are doing wrong. Totally the contrary. We defend those wrong positions, almost ready to die for it. I am calling for a total restoration of the real meanings of the Torah, to understanding according to the times, not according to what literally say, but what is the intention of the Torah. Do you know that before the Torah was given, for you ladies, you need to listen this carefully. You were not considered human beings. You were considered a commodity. We could buy you, sell you, transfer you, giving you away, even kill you. Do you know that without the Torah, slavery was something very bad? And the Torah gave the slave people, the servants, gave the right to be human beings. And I can keep telling you about, but those things, of course, today when we talk about women being inferior to men, or the people being a slave, we say, oh no, that doesn't happen. Doesn't happen, it still exists. The only thing is we have changed the names, but it's still the same thing. We still have slaves. We still have the woman under everything. All depends how we see it. And then you have reactionary groups who instead to understand the meaning, what the Torah tells us, they react and they impose their own understandings. Do you know? I say in this way because this is the area that is so difficult sometimes to talk. In these passages, God tells us that homosexuality is wrong. It is not a way of life. It is not a certain way of life. It is not something good. That's what the Torah told us. Of course, so decrepit, so old, so evil thinking. No, we need to understand the principle of why. Anything contra natura, destruction of us as humanity. That's what our Creator was trying to protect us from. We can take it in the moral issue, more morality, and holier than thou, I am better than you, or I can see that. No, we need to see why he said that's not right. Because if the world becomes homosexual, if we call it this way, it's going to come a point of total destruction of the species. Because doesn't matter how much we have advanced in medicine. You can do surgery and you can change from one side to the other, but you cannot procreate. Oh, now we have in vitro fertilization, we have all those things, you know, and now we have passed. But the truth of the matter is, it's contra natura. Now, we say that we have the right to judge these people. The one that judged him, blessed be his name. But at the same time, like I repeated to you again, one of the problems that we are suffering today, not only with this issue, but with many other issues, is that we have been imposed to accept wrong ideas, or for us, wrong morality. And the worst part it is, I mean, we protest, or we say something that we do not like it, and it's not popular among the rest of the people, we are called bigots. We are called extremists. We are called even terrorists. Or we are called religious fanatics. And there is no balance. I always say that the law cannot legislate morality. It's impossible. You know? We as human beings, we are our own legislators in morality. And when we have the Torah, we are constantly struggling with our morality. We are struggling. We struggle. Those ones who don't have the Torah, they can free to do whatever they want to do. They think that they are free. But the only thing that they are doing is going to the self-destruction. That's my personal idea. But one thing that is very important, we also have the right to give our opinion. You know, right now in the schools, it's almost imposed and forced to accept certain type of mentality. The question is, what about if I don't believe in that way? I need to get out of the school? Right now, I don't know, in the United States, there is a big problem in the schools. I don't know if you have been reading in the news about the bathrooms. Now they're making unisex bathrooms, you know, and this is specifically for the transgender sex students, who is a little bitty minority. We are changing all the way. What about if comes a child that has grown up in a home who his parents has told them that type of behavior is wrong, and goes to school, and the teacher says, you are wrong, your parents are wrong. That's not right, that's not true. I remember that in the 80s or 70s, that happened with the school when they were about talking about if we were we coming from the monkey, or we were not, you know, creationism or spooky, you know, and that was a big controversy. You know, now if you are a very intelligent person, if you are a very sophisticated and you're a very educated person, you will never ever believe in creationism. You need to believe in the spooky way, you know?
Darwin.
That way. Darwin is already and more scientists are proving the contrary. That is the same idea of Galileo Galilei, when the church started to tell you, you know, that the earth was flat, and then after the earth goes around the sun and not the sun around the earth, you know, all of that. And if you didn't believe according to them, they'll kill you. What is the difference today? And we need to accommodate them. Then, when our Creator say, Kedoshim Tiju, Ki Kadosh Ani Adonai Lechem. Because I am special, I am unique, and there is nothing like me. I am bringing you to me, and you belong to me, and you are part of me. And being part of him, he has given us the Torah, to follow the Torah, exactly what our Messiah Yeshua told us. I have not come to destroy it. I have not come to abolish. I have come to make it work. My question to all of you is that happening? And if you are honest in your answer, you will say, stop, no. And doesn't matter if you are Christian, doesn't matter if you are ultra-Orthodox Jew, doesn't matter if you are a Muslim, the truth of the matter is that's not happening. Why? Because each one of those religions has their own way to interpret it, the Word of God, and to see it in the way that is convenient to them. And the traditions are stronger than the truth. And their own tradition has destroyed the truth, the Word of God. I want to tell you that it's time that we wake up. It's the time that we start following our Creator, not following me. I am going to tell you that this last year has been very, very hard for us. Has not been easier. Because many people come here looking for a religion. And I cannot give them a religion. Totally the contrary. I want to take them out from the religion that they are. I wish that they can come out. They can think on their own. I have told you many times to convert from one religion to another religion is only a lateral step, to the right or to the left, depending where you are. But to have a relationship with the Creator is a vertical, perpendicular way. You don't need to have a religion. You need to have a relationship with the Creator. You know, our Messiah Yeshua, when he was confronted, he said, you know, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. At the time of Yeshua, already existed the problem of euphemism. And he was respectful of many of those things in order to be heard by the people. And one of the euphemistic terms was truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. You know, when you're a Greek mentality, when you come from the Western mentality, you immediately you think, I'm going to learn, and I'm going to understand knowledge. You know, and I'm going to decipher God, and I'm going to put God in a box. And that's what the religions do. They put God in a box. There is a science called systematic theology in the Christian world. It's a system in which the word theology, theos, logos, that means the word of the learning of God, there have been, God has been divided in chapters, in representations. And they have the answer for everything. And if they don't have an answer, they call it, what do they call it? It is an enigma. Do you know? And because it's an enigma, we need to accept it by faith. So, when you get in a trouble, it's an enigma. It's okay. You know? Then, they have divided. What I am saying to you, you cannot put God in a box. The one that knew that very well was Shlomo HaMelech. Read in 1 Kings chapter 8 when he built the huge temple for the Creator. He said, well, I can build a temple where I can put you inside. It's impossible. You know, I say, you know, the change of religion, I would say, or the converted to one religion, I call it a lateral step. You know, you go from religion A, you pass to religion B. And why you go to religion B? Because they look like nicer. Or because they say this and they don't say that. Like that one to make a big difference. You know? But what about, do you know God? Let me change the direction. Does God know you? This is even much better. You see, because the word to know has nothing to do with knowledge. Many people talk in how much I acquire. But in the Hebrew language, the Yodea means intimate relationship. And what our Creator is saying, what Yeshua is saying, you shall know the truth. That's the euphemistic term to say, you shall know God. And the truth shall make you free. God will set you free. How? Because He's going to take away all the things that are holding you back. And you finally are going to be free to have a direct relationship with Him, and you don't need intermediaries. Because you can go directly to Him. I don't need somebody to hear my sins to forgive me. I don't need to go to somebody else to tell me how to reach God, because God is going to reach me. The prophets, Ezekiel and Jeremiah, speak about that. And they tell us that is the God who is the heart transplant surgeon. He does a wonderful heart transplant. He changes this heavy, rocky heart for a heart of flesh that can feel, move. And He is going to cleanse us, and He is going to make us totally new. And He is going to put His word in us. That means that He is going to be with us. He revealed Himself to us. Then what does it mean to be kadosh, to be holy, in the sense that God is talking about? It is not to be better than anybody else. It's not to be immaculate. Doesn't mean that I am better than anybody else. But what it means, it is that I belong to Him. And because I belong to Him, I have a relationship. And nobody can take me away from that relationship. And even when I do wrong, He is faithful. And He's waiting for me to pick me up. And when I do Teshuvah. And Teshuvah is mean to go back to Him, to acknowledge not only my wrongdoings, but repairing those wrongdoings and to start again. Because my God, the God of the Bible, is the God of the beginning.